to each of you this morning. We welcome all of you to the service of worship and invite everyone to sign the fringes register that you'll find in the center of each aisle. After you've signed it, please pass it to those seated next to you that we may have record of everyone's attendance. This morning we will have a congregational meeting. It will be immediately after the service this morning, and the purpose of the meeting is simply to hear the review of the 2017 financial picture, as well as to hear the budget for 2018. All members are encouraged to attend, and it should be about a 5 or 6 minute meeting, something in that neighborhood. This is also Prayer Partner Exchange Sunday, and we want to encourage all that would like to fill out a prayer partner exchange form. It's a little yellow page this time. As you have filled one out, then here after a while, in fact, Marilyn is back and back and has those forms. If you would like to fill one out and haven't done so, please raise your hand and she'll come to you. I think we're good. Then, as we have the offering this morning, immediately after the offering, they'll come back with folded sheets of paper with other people's names on them. We encourage you to pick out one name. If it happens to be your own name, put it back in and take another name out. If you have not signed up for that this morning, please don't take a name, so we have enough for those who have exchanged. This afternoon at 1:30, we will have a worship committee meeting, and evangelism is at 2:30. Then the Martin Luther King Jr. service for the community is going to be at Shiloh AME Zion Church on Powerhouse Road in Morganton at 4 p.m. The Praley Street Acre of Grace did their planting yesterday with their seed planting. They've ordered their seeds and they're ready to go, and the first day of activity will be January 27th. Your offering envelopes, if you've not picked them up yet, you'll find them back in the narthex this morning. We encourage all of you to get your offering envelopes for the coming year. And then Dinner for Eight group is on a blue sheet in the bulletin this morning. If you would like to sign up for that, on the back side of that blue sheet, after it describes it on one side, on the other side is a sign-up sheet for you to do so. You may put that in the offering envelope, the offering this morning, and it will get to the committee people that are leading that event. And also there's an advertisement for the special fallow. The fallow is the bonfire, and in Waldensian history, on February 17, 1848, with the Edict of Emancipation, the bonfires were lit across the mountains of the Alps, and so that is a signature event for us that we always celebrate on around February 17th. With this being a Saturday night on February 17th, we planned this year, our 125th year, to have a community-wide, town-wide event at the Rock School. So please, if you would like, sign up for the meal and then afterwards for the program that will happen. Let us prepare our hearts for the worship of God.
Thank you. The one who calls you together this day yearns for each of you and for all people to hear and be blessed.
Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening.
Blessed is the one who comes bringing trustworthy words for the healing of this world.
Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening.
Friends, this saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Amen.
morning.
Good morning.
How you guys doing?
Good.
Hang on a second, I can't see you too well. Let me put my glasses on. Good gosh, John, you weren't kidding. I can't see the... All right, so what are these here?
Glasses.
That's right. Why would I be wearing these?
Because you're
seeing. So you can see better. These help me to see better, right? That's absolutely right. Hey, what else do we wear to help us to see better? Contacts, that's right. What about sunglasses? Now, I usually have sunglasses on. When do they help you see better? That's right. Sun's in my eyes. I just throw my sunglasses on real quick. I can see. What else helps us see good? Huh? Hats. What about a telescope? Joseph Heilman got a telescope for Christmas. You think it helps him to see the moon better? Yeah. That's right. What about this? What is this?
A scope.
A scope helps you see better, right? Today we're learning a passage where Jesus runs into this guy and he speaks to him and he says, "Ah, here comes this great person. I remember you sitting under the tree." And that person said, "What? When did you see me?" But Jesus saw him. What did Jesus use to see him?
Glasses.
No. He didn't use his glasses. That's a good guess, though, Valerie. But how did he watch him if he wasn't even there?
He washed him in spirit.
Okay, he washed him in spirit. That's right, Wade.
Yeah,
all right. Hey, you know, sometimes we can watch people even when we're not close to them. What do we use to watch people we're not close to?
FaceTime,
that's right. That's not a big deal, Jesus. We've got FaceTime. We've got drones, don't we? We can watch people in Iraq with drones. But guess what? Before all the technology came along, there was one, and still is, who can always see us and who always knows what we're thinking and where we're at. And that one, Jesus, loves you very much and knows you through and through. Always remember that. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you, that you see us, and that you always see us clearly, that you understand us. You see our faults, the very things we can't even figure out about ourselves. We can't see those things clearly. But Lord, you can. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you know us and that you accept us. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you.
that have been raised this week. First, Molly Murray is scheduled, or will be scheduled soon, for some surgery. She's had some gallbladder issues, and so that will be addressed at a later time with surgery. Jim Cockerham has been struggling with pneumonia, and I got a text from him last night saying that he's doing much better, but still seeks our prayers. David Weese has had a hip replacement on Wednesday of this past week. Speaking of hips, Margaret Blaynock fell and broke her hip last evening, and so she's had surgery overnight and is doing well and joking with the hospital staff already this morning. Vicki Waldrop, mother of Ryan Freeman, is on our list, and she evidently was in the hospital but has gone home, and I think they're treating her with medication for her heart. Marie Wood, who is Loy Ray and Doris Burris' daughter, has had a return of cancer, and so they are now treating her for that. I got a call yesterday, as many of us got texts throughout the week, about Joseph Pritchard, Marnie's husband. He's had a second stroke, and there is a blood clot in the carotid artery that they're having to address, and it's a pretty, very serious situation, so we keep Marnie and Joseph in our prayers. Leslie will be back with choir on Wednesday evening. I know our choir will be pleased. And Brenda Zimmerman's nephew, Larry Berner, had foot and circulation problems and possibly may lose that foot. Joyce Mahaffey, who is Alan Griffin's aunt, is that correct, Alan? We keep her in our prayer because her husband died this past Monday and she is also sick, so keep Joyce in your prayers. Are there other pastoral concerns that any of us know about this morning? Yes. Francis Tron, yes. Just John mentioned this morning that Francis Tron is in the hospital with some influenza, so keep her in our prayers. Yes. Parsons, a member of this church, she and her husband now have moved and lived up in the Boone area. But Marsha has had cancer and breast cancer, and they have treated it with chemotherapy, and ahead will be radical mastectomies as well as further chemo and more radiation. So this is a very hard run for her. She's not responding well to the power of the chemotherapy. So keep her in your prayers. Anyone else? Let us pray. Our hearts are heavy, Lord, when we consider the number of people in our church that are going through health issues, those who are recovering from surgery, others who are going through difficult times with radiation and chemo for cancer treatments, still others who are recovering from heart situations, and we ask your blessing and guiding spirit to be with those individuals. Be with Joseph Pritchard as he goes through this time of waiting for a procedure to be done and knowing that it is a very risky procedure for him. We ask, O God, that your love and direction will be with people who have lost loved ones, be of a source of strength and comfort for Joyce as well as for many others in our congregation who grief is a fresh memory and a living presence in their lives. We pray that you will restore them with peace and restore them with promise of resurrection life, so that as they grieve, they do so mindful that the loss that they have has now been received fully into the joy of your kingdom. Lord, we ask your blessing to be with our sister congregation down in Nueva Jerusalem in Guatemala. Strengthen and guide them in their outreach and ministry, and be with them as they too grieve the loss of a deacon this past week. We ask that you also guide our efforts as a congregation as we seek to reach out through our community assistance ministry in the pantry, through our garden that we are planning for again this spring, through the many ways that church members offer service and volunteer their efforts to help to alleviate people's hunger and issues that are many in this community. And we ask, O God, your blessing of love to be with our children. Guide them as they continue to grow in faith. We celebrate the number of children we have in this congregation and ask you to continue to be a blessing so that we may guide them with wisdom and joy. Help us in all that we do, Heavenly Father, to be faithful to you, honoring the relationship that we have in Jesus Christ, recognizing the power of your love to renew even in the darkness of this world. So we ask that we be strengthened by our faith and by our faithful witness to you in Jesus' name. For it's in his name that we pray together the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. first, let us turn to God in prayer. We hear many people, Lord, with invitations and calls in our lives, and we need to refocus so that the one that we respond to each and every day is your call. We ask your blessing now as we understand and try to discern your word for our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. From John 1, starting with the 43rd chapter, 43rd verse. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said to him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree?" And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the word of the Lord. There was a man who lost his wife and child to a terrible auto accident. He was a very wealthy man, and he remained the rest of his life unmarried. When he died, his fabulous estate was to be auctioned off in a single event. He had gold statuary, silver service sets, paintings by great masters, many land holdings and houses and automobiles. The day of the auction, many people showed up to bid on those items. The auctioneer invited all to bid first on a painting of the man's wife and son that was commissioned by a regional artist. The auctioneer started out the bidding of the painting at $500, but no one bid anything. The auctioneer waited on a bid from the audience, and in the silence he heard some folks start to say, "Come back to the painting later. Move on to the good stuff." The auctioneer patiently waited, and the silence continued. Finally, a woman who had been a former employee of the wealthy family broke the silence and bid all the money she had available, $100. She had loved the son when he was a small boy and grew to love him as a young man and had deep respect for the mother who always had treated her as a member of the family. The retired woman couldn't bear to see this portrait go unappreciated. The auctioneer picked up his gavel and said, "I have $100. Who will make it to?" Silence. There were no takers. Then someone in the crowd who had grown impatient with the delays said, "Let the old woman have it for $100 for Pete's sake. Let's move on." The auctioneer brought the gavel down, sold for $100. Then he announced, "Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the auction. Thank you for coming." A near riot broke out amongst the many people who had come to bid on the real treasures. "What about the good stuff? When will we get to bid?" The auctioneer hammered his gavel several times until the crowd settled down so that he could make the announcement. "Ladies and gentlemen," he said, "the will is quite explicit. The person who loves the wife and the son well enough to purchase a portrait inherits the entire estate." Our scripture passage today asks us the same underlying question that the people at the auction faced. What do we value most? Said another way, do our actions coincide with the spiritual value that we place on our relationship to Christ? Obviously, the father in the story wanted his love for his family to be valued more than the mountains of wealth that he had accumulated. So much so that he was willing to give all the wealth away to the one individual who bid on the wife's and son's portrait. Our relationship with God and Christ is a little bit like that. Let's turn to the scripture this morning. Philip speaks for Andrew, Peter, and himself. All three of these guys had come from the town of Bethsaida. And he approaches Nathanael. Full of enthusiasm, Philip makes an astounding claim. We have found him, about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. Here is the irony. At this point in John's text, Jesus has performed no miracles. He has shown no sign and engaged in no teaching. Jesus has presented no great proclamation about the reign of God that would excite the imagination of Philip or anyone else. And yet, Philip sees in him the fully divine presence of God. I guess you had to be there to experience that and understand what he was trying to convey. Quite naturally, the reaction of the man Nathanael indicates that just hearing about this was not enough to convince him. We can imagine Nathanael asking, where did you say he was from? Nazareth, of all places. Kind of like saying Elvis came from Tupelo, Mississippi, isn't it? Can anything good come from Nazareth or Tupelo or Abbey's Grove? But in that passage, the application of the title Son of God, Messiah, King of Israel, to the man Jesus of Nazareth is validated by Jesus' profound ability to exercise divine authority and power. Against this understanding of Jesus, Philip, Andrew, and Peter hear the call to follow, and they do just that. Jesus finds Philip. Philip finds Nathanael, but because Nathanael didn't have that direct connection and had not really met this Jesus yet, he remained skeptical. Many of us, if we're honest with ourselves, have times when we are skeptical about who Jesus is. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? For Nathanael, Nazareth was a little backwater crossroads. Obviously, no place for God's appointed Messiah to call home. And then in the text, we encounter one of the most effective evangelistic responses in all of the scriptures. Three words. Come and see. Philip issues a single invitation. No sales pitch. No inflated promises about what they might discover, no cajoling, no guilt trips, not even a $50 gift card. Come and see, he says. Invitations. You and I get them all the time on the cell phone and text or unsolicited calls. You have been selected to receive a, and if you act now in the next 5 minutes, I hope most of us know we don't have to act in 5 minutes when we get that kind of call. These special offers that come. Hi, I'm Kelly, calling from the Vacation Prize Giveaway gift card. And of course, all of us get those unsolicited invitations that really are summons to appear. You've been selected by the magistrate of the 5th District Court, U.S. Court, to appear for jury duty on Monday, January 15th. We receive other more casual invitations that come with the expectation that we bring something along when we come to dinner, like a bottle of wine, maybe our best behavior, maybe a friend, or maybe something else to eat. Then there are those we've received invitations that come with the expectations that we arrive knowing that we're going to be asked to contribute to something, even if it's not our worthy cause. And then there are the invitations to the pampered chef parties. You know, to take your checkbook and a mental list of what you're willing to buy, and more importantly, what you won't buy. Some of us have been invited to the free dinner parties, which include a sales pitch, a timeshare destination vacation home, all yours for a low of $250 per month for the next 20 years. The older I get, the easier it is for me to say no to these kinds of invitations. Thank you for calling, but I am not interested. Goodbye. But the invitation that Philip offers Nathanael is a very different kind of invitation. Nathanael, we found it, about whom Moses and the law and the prophets wrote. It's the thing they had waited for all their lives, this Messiah that was promised that is now before them. Come and see, he says. How many people do we know that are searching from the bookshelves at the Barnes & Noble, willing to pay $29.95 for the latest and greatest book from a psychoanalyst on how to make our lives happier? How many people head off halfway across the country to a special retreat center, willing to pay the ticket cost and take a week out of their life and all the extra energy that goes into that to find happiness or peace? Sometimes we go to what lengths to search for the secrets of life when maybe they're available right before us. Here, without cost, without great investment of time or energy, are three little words: come and see. How many accept or decline? No need to get changed into a suit and tie or a gown. You don't need to pack your bags and arrange your life for a week. No need to bring a hostess gift or even respond with an RSVP. Come and see. And while we're on the topic, go ahead and bring your skepticism, your cynicism, your doubts. Come and see here. What might happen if we church people emulated Philip and his invitation to Nathanael? What if we stop feeling embarrassed about our relationships with Jesus Christ and simply issued an invitation to our neighbors? Now I know, because I've heard some of you saying, "Preacher, that's just not my thing. I don't like to invite other people." But we tend to discount the very strengths that each of us have. The relationships you have that are one-on-one with someone else you've known a long time. And if you happen to be there when they are saying things like, "My life is in shambles, I'm not sure where to turn or what to do," and you miss that opportunity to extend an invitation to come and see, no one else can do that like you can. Maybe the fact that we're uncomfortable with inviting people to church is the reason that in 2017 we had four new members. Four. First time since I've been here that we've had that few members to join. Three times the amount of that number for the deaths that we had that year. And yes, the Committee of Evangelism is trying to do a job in being more effective in our outreach, but we need your help. I cannot address that without the help of every member of this church. What if we stop feeling defensive and self-conscious about our faith, and we started being invitational? Instead of feeling like we had to defend against the criticisms that are out there that we all hear. Oh yes. Those criticisms ring pretty strongly. And sometimes people get turned off to the institutional church, and they'll let us know that. But what if our response was simply, here is what I found in this particular setting. Come and see. That's an open invitation. They can say no to it. That's fine. But we've extended an invitation. No doubt some of those members will say things to us, or those neighbors. Nothing good can come out of Christianity, however justified their opinion in their minds. Come and see. All they ever do at that church is ask for money. Come and see. You Christians are so judgmental and exclusive. Come and see. Worship is boring. Come and see. No one will speak to me when I come to that church. Come and see. I'm so far beyond being saved. Come and see. Guess what, folks? 2018 is a wonderful opportunity for us as a congregation. Not just because it's our 125th, although there will be events throughout the year we can invite people to. But there are events every single week in our life as a faith community to invite people to. What if we were to think about once a week, who can I invite to church on Sunday? This will be Lent, we have Ash Wednesday, we have Holy Week services, Monday, Thursday, Easter sunrise, music appreciation, and the list goes on and on throughout the year. And a big homecoming event in November to invite all former members and friends and family back. And what if we were to invite someone to our Wednesday afternoon program for children, or the Bible study at 5 o'clock, or the dinner, which oftentimes is very good and you cannot get a better deal for $5. Like Philip, we're not to cajole or convince or even sugarcoat. Rather, share what we found here. Ask yourselves, what about this church feeds me? Why am I here? On a cold morning, why are you here? What do you hope to get? What have you gotten in the past? And how can God speak to you? When we can answer those questions, then we are ready to share a little tidbit of that to someone else with the invitation, come and see. Maybe it's for you, maybe not, but come and see. And just like the line of Philip, we need to articulate how we found Christ in our relationship here at WPC, the one whom Moses and the law and all the prophets foretold, the Messiah. How does a community of faith feed your faith? Answer it and extend an invitation. There are things in your life that you love so much you want to share them with others. Most of the time it's our children, right? Most of the time. You feel that way about your pets. Maybe the great feeling you had after exercising and the great physical workout. Maybe it's a favorite red or white wine, a wonderful flavor and brand of ice cream, a great restaurant, movie, or book, whatever it is for you. I challenge you this day to think of your faith in Christ and your relationship with this body of Christ in that same enthusiastic and contagious dynamic in your life. Share it. Share it with someone else. Open invitation. They can say no. It's not about you. is an open invitation. We can imagine ourselves as we think. I heard one member this week say, I cannot imagine what my life would have been like without this church. That itself is a powerful invitation. Come and see. That is what Christ asks us to do. All his followers, new followers and old, come and see and to share the good news. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to invite you to stand and join with me in the affirmation of faith you'll find in the bulletin. This comes from the New Testament book of Colossians, and it is about Jesus Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Please be seated. We have an opportunity to say thank you to God for the promises God has given us. In a few moments after the offering has come by you, then the prayer partner exchange forms will come by. Again, if you put one in, take one out. Now let us give our gratitude and thanksgiving to God.
Christ, for his presence in this world to show us the way, but also to show us the love, that we too may give our lives in gratitude and love to others. We ask these in Christ's name. Amen.
Gracious God, you have blessed this congregation with a bountiful year. You continue to bless it with hope for the future. As we consider the events of this past year and the financial picture, we ask your blessing to be with us this day, not only for this day, but in the days ahead. Now guide us as we discern the truth that is shared with us, in Jesus' name, amen. For the purpose of our meeting today is for the explicit purpose of hearing the budget and hearing also how we came out of the financial report for 2017. So I'd like to call John Howman forward. You will be handed out a summary bulletin about how things have gone financially, and John will be explaining that to you. John?
Okay, while they're handing out the handouts, I want to remind you to, we still have some offering envelopes in the back. Some of you are here, that I saw was back there. Be sure to pick those up if you can, choir included. There might be some back there. That's one of the ways we're saving funds, and I'll get into that in just a minute more. But when that, they're about finished there, see. And I'm not sure who put the flowers in the sanctuary, but they are indeed beautiful. I'm not sure who did that this morning, but thank you for that.
Are they artificial?
Well, they are artificial. They're beautiful artificial flowers. Mom used to have a bunch of zinnias in the den where she always stays. And everybody that came in thought they were beautiful. And they were, but they were always artificial. They were always bloomed like that. I'll put this down my poor eyesight. We'll need some up here. And we thank John and whoever else did that. I'm not sure who. Don't do that. Before we dive into the 2018 budget, this first thing we're going to end up in 2017. If everybody would open the handout inside the two inside covers, is what we'll be looking at. Our budget for 2017 was for $505,074, with our committee spending a little bit more than they did, than they was budgeted, and our personnel spending a little less than they could have. We ended up having expenditures of $503,374. So we spent $1,700 less than was budgeted. So that's great, right? Well, let's yes and no, and let's look at it a little bit closer. We have some endowed funds that can only be used for certain purposes. From one of these funds, the unrestricted endowment fund, the church has the ability to pull up to 5% off of it for our May 5 commitments. Of that 5%, the session allows half of that to flow directly into the budget as a supplement to meet our budgetary requirements. This year's allotment was $41,102. And I'll try not to bore you with log numbers, but of the $41,000, we used $39,410 to balance the 2017 budget. Without these yearly allotments, we would be in a deficit situation almost every single year for the last 10 years. Fortunately, the amount next year would be $44,698. However, the one item that saved us from having a deficit for 2017 is the Benice Trust Fund. It's kind of in bold print about halfway down the first box you see on the left. The church was named beneficiary of this fund many years ago, I'm not even sure when, and it is totally outside our control. We just graciously accept what is given out to us each year. For 2017, we thought the fund would only produce about $14,000 in income to use. In actuality, it was a good year. It was $18,000 was given out to us. Without the additional $4,000, we would have indeed been in a budget, a deficit of $1,692 for 2017. Both of these funds, both of these situations indicate the importance of good stewardship and the ability of this church to draw off other income sources as income besides our regular church pledges to meet our budgetary needs. So for 2018, our efforts were directed to keeping our budget under tight control, knowing that our pledge and overall income had not changed substantially from last year, from 2017. Stewardship and Finance regretfully recommended and the session reluctantly approved the 2018 budget that is basically at the same level as in 2017. Now that budget for 2018 is on the back page. We've been able to balance this year's budget, 2018, through maintaining the same level of expenditures and on reliance on some monies made available from some of our other established funds. For example, Christian Education Committee will use $2,762 from the Youth and Young Adult Expansion Program Fund. The Mission Committee will make use of the Mission Trips Fund and the GIGU Education Fund to supply them with $3,800 for their budget. Proctor will use $1,700 from the Philip Gardner Maintenance Fund in renovating Room 200, and that's going on presently. All these total a little over $1,800. We will be using all the monies, from the Youth Young Adult Fund and from the Groove Fund, so they will not be available for use in 2019. So if we need those funds next year, we won't have them. We need these funds for our pledges are down a little bit this year. Last year it was almost $425,000. As we budgeted this year, it's a little short of $419,000. So they're down about $6,000. And this is principally because we've had deaths in the congregation. We are not, we haven't replaced those monies coming in. So that's why we had to pull on these other sources. We have also looked for possible savings. Thanks to the diligent work of Kevin, Rita, and the rest of the staff, and the use of some new technology and contracts, our office expense budget is $18,050. 2 years ago, it was $8,500 higher. They've done a great job just conserving and minimizing what they can. The property committee, for their part, has changed every light on campus to LED bulbs that use less electricity and have changed all thermostats to programmable ones to save on our electrical use. So I challenge the congregation, that's one committee, but we challenge the congregation to think of new and innovative ways that we can decrease spending without sacrificing the effectiveness of our programs. Of course, as in any church, there are usually two large groupings of expenditures. One is the before-mentioned property committee, which constitutes 24% of our budget. Taking care of the campus with 100-year-old buildings, it's expensive. Property increased this year by $5,200 in the costs because of the cost savings we achieved in the office line that I just mentioned. Oftentimes, stewardship and finance consider these two budgets as one because they're kind of intertwined. So essentially, for 2018, nothing increased in the budget for property and office expenses. They all came up to the same thing. The other is the personnel budget, which takes 59% of the budget. Last year was 58. There is a slight increase slated for this year in the 2018 budget. Now, some of you may consider 59% to be a large percentage, and it is. But I need to point out that for a church our size, this is a typical number. Some churches, in doing some research a year or so ago, go up to 70% range for their personnel. And this really hampers their ability to do the things they really need to do. The benevolence budget is at the same level as in 2017. Remember, this is only our budgeted benevolence items. As part of the Generations Music Ministry, the session has designated $15,000 a year for the next 4 years to go to benevolences. We've already done $15,000 for 2017. So this will be 5 years of $15,000 or $75,000. And this does not count the monies that individuals each give independently to the church for benevolent causes, and that can be very substantial. So for 2018, we are presenting as a budget of $504,358. And remember that session has already approved this, using the entire before mentioned $44,698 for that 2.5% withdrawal, we should be able to balance this year's budget. Now, this is just a summary. If you want a more detailed breakdown, we can get it for you. Please talk to Rita, Sheila, or myself, and we'll make sure you get one. If anyone has any questions, I'll be glad to try to answer them at the moment.
Any questions from the floor?
No, I must question. This appears to be a typo, but you might want to look at it. But on the back page, it clearly says that the figures of our income are for 2018 budget. The second thing on the program says 2017 budget. Mm-hmm.
That should be 2018, yes. I did not catch that.
Those figures are for 2018.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Picking up on that, Tom. Anyone else? Again, the committee will be available for your questions and comments at any time in the future. So please keep a running dialogue. And our intention is to be transparent. And I think you will see that without the availability of our endowment monies, that we would be having to make staff cuts and possibly benevolence cuts, that the benevolence or the endowment monies have enabled us to continue to have a strong programmatic as well as mission outreach emphasis in this church. Thank you, John. Without any further business to conduct, I'll entertain a motion that we conclude our congregational meeting. It's been moved. Is there a second? I hear a second. Let us conclude then with a benediction. May the Lord keep and abide each of you in eternal life. May God, who promises to reveal himself to us in the human form, continue to bless us as we seek to reveal Christ in our own lives. Go then with confidence, go with grace, go with God's power, which is yours to claim. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.